Hey everyone, welcome back to the DevOps Lab. I'm Damien, and today we are talking about MLflow and how to use that with Azure Machine Learning with PM Shivani Patel. It's pretty cool stuff, don't miss it. Hey everyone, welcome back to the DevOps Lab. Today we are talking about MLflow and how that can work with Azure Machine Learning with my guest, Shivani Patel. So Shivani, thanks so much for joining us.
Yep, thanks for having me.
Awesome. So you are a PM on the Azure Machine Learning project, correct? And you've been focusing on MLflow for a little while.
Yeah. So I primarily work on focusing on the ML lifecycle. So things like MLOps, open source, MLflow, all that kind of
awesome. So MLflow, for those who aren't familiar as well, can you explain a little bit about what MLflow is?
Yes, definitely. So there's kind of four components to MLflow. It's basically an open source platform for managing your ML lifecycle, which is exactly what I work on, right? So that includes four components here. So you have your tracking. So this means recording things like data, the code that you're running, the experiments that you're running, and being able to query them later on and manage them throughout your lifecycle. The second one is the MLflow project. So that's just basically a way to package up your code and run it. So if you are familiar with AzureML concepts, it's very similar to a run configuration. And then you have MLflow models in the model registry. So very similar to AzureML, they do have a definition of models. And these models have metadata as well as version and a couple of different properties like framework version. And they also have a model registry, which pretty much stores your models. Again, very similar to Azure Machine Learning. And then in those registries, you know, for your experiments and your models, you can go in and query those. Look at metrics, track metrics, visualize them.
So does this in a way kind of abstract away like the implementation of how this stuff works? And it's a kind of a higher level, an open source definition of how you describe all of these things.
Exactly. So it makes it really simple to start tracking your workflows, doing what you already do today, right? So you have a variety of different tools and services that, you know, have a lot of proprietary information. That's where something like, you know, MLflow and open source platform comes in and simplifies that entire process.
Okay. And at some level, you can probably, if you're abstracting this stuff away, you're not tied to, you know, whatever provider is going to provide each of those areas.
Yeah, exactly. And that's one of the benefits of, you know, or one of the reasons why a lot of customers are using MLflow is because, you know, some of them might be using Azure. A lot of them will be using Azure, Databricks, AWS, GCP. So they'll be using a variety of different cloud providers. And their biggest worry, obviously, you know, we hear over and over is cloud vendor lock-in. So by providing interoperability with MLflow, we kind of mitigate that worry with customers.
That's awesome. And it encourages people to do things properly rather than do things the way that their provider specifically wants them to do, I guess, which is,
yeah.
I'm all about that. Yeah. Excellent. So how does Azure Machine Learning support MLflow? Like what are the interactions there? How does that work?
So we've recognized that MLflow is generally becoming a standard for defining models and experiments. So we've decided to basically have a first class integration with MLflow. So that means, you know, you could be working in MLflow, you could be working in AzureML, but we conform to the schema and we are able to track and manage models using their logging API as well. So it really is pretty much you start either in MLflow or AzureML, you set one line of code to link each other, and then you can just work how you normally work and you'll see your metrics, your artifacts in both workspaces, both registries. So this is really useful, again, if you are using different pipelines, different tools, to track your end-to-end workflow. Because keep in mind, MLflow is open source tracking platform. It doesn't provide, you know, your virtual machines, your compute, the GPUs, the whole bulk of infrastructure that AzureML provides. So when you bring those two together, you get, you know, the infrastructure that you want from AzureML and then be able to track it in AzureML as well as MLflow. And then let's say you decide to run something on-prem or in a different cloud provider, you still get that traceability because MLflow is not tied to a single cloud provider.
Right. Oh, that's awesome. Can we, so putting you on the spot here, can we have a look at what this actually looks like in practice? Like, how does it work on the ground?
Yep, definitely. And I'll come back to this, you know, a little bit, we can dive a little bit deeper into why this is really beneficial after I show you what it looks like.
Sure, yeah.
So the first thing I wanted to walk through is just a simple example here of a PyTorch, you know, experiment. So, you know, I've already ran this, but you know, let's say I'm someone that is familiar with AzureML and running through AzureML. Basically, what I've done here is initially import my workspace configuration. So this is, you know, my workspace, which is the top level project, and pull that into this environment. And then just setting up some environment files. You know, this is just the way that I was defining it. And so I have separate files that have these curated environments with different packages that I need to run this training job. Now from there, I'm basically just submitting this job, right? So this is a normal process that we'd see in AzureML. You know, I'll provide, there's plenty of notebooks that go into depth with this, but basically it's a run it, you submit a run. Now, from there, turning this into, you know, let's say an MLflow tracked notebook, all you do, the only difference here is I'm still pulling in my workspace, is the MLflow tracking URI. So I'm basically pointing this tracking URI to my machine learning workspace. So anything that's going on in that workspace now gets automatically tracked into MLflow.
Right. So that's pretty handy and like very simple to connect them.
Yeah, very, very simple. So that's the whole reason why we want to have first-class integration is that we don't want to make it harder for people to, you know, go in between these services or use these services together. We want to make sure it's pretty seamless. So you can see here, let's just discard this. And so you can see, I mean, this is a GitHub repository that I use. So that's some extra information, but I have the experiment that I ran. And if I'm using MLflow, I'll have this kind of information here. The other thing is that when you have these run IDs, they're the same as the MLflow run IDs. So that's another benefit of working with both of them together. If you are using both of them together, setting the tracking URI, you'll get the same run ID, and then you'll get the AzureML benefit of output logs to debug and analyze your training jobs.
Right. Cool.
So that's a pretty simple one. The other one that I mentioned is MLflow projects, right? So MLflow projects is even less difficult, right? So if you are someone who starts in MLflow, for you to start running in AzureML, it's a lot more simplified. So it's a very similar concept of here you go, here's my workspace, right? And if I want to use AzureML compute, great. If I don't want to use it, you'll still get the runs that are tracked in AzureML. So that's kind of the beauty of it here is that you go ahead, set your tracking URI, you set an experiment name, you know, other configurations if you want to use your Conda environment. So right here, basically, you're pointing to the training script, the repository that your code is living in, and then the parameters that you want to use, that you want to pass on for the training job, and then you select AzureML as your backend. This doesn't mean that you are using AzureML Compute to do your training runs. This is a local run, but you can still track in AzureML. So it provides a really seamless story if you are starting locally and still want AzureML to track what you're doing, right? So use MLflow, AzureML, run it locally. Once you're ready to scale to the cloud, you just change this backend config, right? You add a compute parameter. And I'll show you an example of that right here. So in this case, I've just defined the CPU cluster that I want to use. So these are very, you know, simple examples of how easy it is to start tracking in AzureML if you are an MLflow user or if you are an AzureML user and want to start using MLflow.
Right. And like we saw a few big advantages there. One, especially, it doesn't matter where you're running it. If you're running it, you know, in the cloud in AzureML or running it locally, you still get that consistent kind of code. So you don't need to change a lot to suddenly move it to the cloud, and you still get that consistent tracking regardless of where you're moving it. So that's really handy. There's a few different ways that you can connect that, we saw as well. And I'll point out as well, you mentioned that not necessarily the specific code, but code that shows all of this stuff happening is available on GitHub. You can pick it up and run it for yourself. We'll make sure that that's in the show notes below. So you also mentioned that you were going to jump back and talk about some of the specific examples of why it's useful to use these two together. And we saw a couple there, but I wanted to dive a little bit deeper into some of those. Like, why would we use MLflow and AzureML?
Yeah, definitely. Let's head back to... Sorry, not the smoothest transition. So back to AzureML and MLflow. Now I'll show you guys a couple examples of projects and a simple experiment. The reason a few reasons why it becomes very useful is there's a lot of customers that are using Databricks, and Databricks also has a lot of MLflow support. But if their needs are not fulfilled with Databricks, or if they're trying to use AzureML, you can't really get around it without using MLflow, because MLflow is the one that ties all of them together, right? So if you are using specifically Databricks, it's a really smooth transition into using AzureML with MLflow. The other thing is the interoperability that I just showed from going from on-prem to scaling up ML workloads. It makes it really simple if you are working in MLflow to set your configurations, whether or not you're using projects, test and run things locally. MLflow has APIs and CLI that allow you to run jobs locally on your own computer. And then once you're ready to scale up to Azure Compute or any other compute, makes it really simple to just change a simple configuration.
That's super useful. Sorry, I just wanted to drill into that one, because that's a really powerful thing for ML, because when you're trying stuff locally, you want to make sure that you have a proof of concept before you fire it off into the cloud and potentially spend hours and hours and thousands of dollars on a long training run. But you still want that consistency between the two runs, right? You don't want to have a completely different scenario when you're testing things locally to when you're doing it in the cloud in your pipeline, the thing that you're going to deploy to production. That really stands out for me. That's really cool.
Yeah, definitely. It's made it a lot better and more efficient for me to iterate quickly on tests, even myself, when I want to just run a quick job and see what the outputs are, versus using, compute, which might take a little bit of time to spin up and then run, as well as going over quota.
Yes. Yeah, of course.
I'm in trouble for that.
Yep. Yeah. I can imagine. And sorry, I interrupted you before you got to that last point.
No worries. The third point I was going to make is that if you've seen MLflow, they have a lot of support for frameworks. So when you try to deploy models or, even do training jobs in AzureML, you have specific configurations you set, as well as deployment configs. So you have a scoring script that you define to actually load the model and deploy it. With MLflow, and one of the biggest push to integrate so tightly with them is they simplify that deployment process. You don't necessarily have to create a scoring script. There are a set of frameworks that MLflow supports. So you pretty much do, MLflow.azure.deploy, no scoring script, no configs necessary. We pull all that information from the model. I can show you what that looks like real quick here. So what I mean by model is, this is how we pull the information from the model. So there's that conda environment that's defining all the dependencies the model needs. So there's the conda environments that you can define here. The ML model file defines a path to the model, as well as the frameworks that it's using. So that's exactly what I was talking about earlier, right? There's different frameworks that MLflow supports. They have an extensive list. You can obviously create custom modules for any custom frameworks that you have. But all this information is logged there, right? And then you have the model file itself. So the way that they define their model makes it really simple to go ahead and package it up and deploy it.
Yeah, it's really clear. I remember earlier, before MLflow was kind of supported, in the early days of AML, sometimes, the model was whatever you put in that artifact. So having this consistent way is awesome. It seems to add a lot more maturity to the systems as well.
Yeah, definitely. It's a lot easier. And I've been on this team for over 2 years now, and I've seen the progression from what models used to be to what they are now. And it's significantly easier.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, that's really cool. So I was pretty excited by this announcement when I read it. If people want to learn more about it, we'll put some stuff in the show notes, but where's the best place to get started, do you think?
So I would start, you could even do a simple search of Azure Machine Learning and how to use MLflow. You get this full list of what is the difference between all of these tracking services and packages and ways that you can interact with AzureML and MLflow. And then from here, there's tons of resources, for example, notebooks, right? So this is going to be the best one
to look awesome. At. And we'll definitely put that link in the show notes as well. And a few others as well. There's plenty of ways to learn about Azure Machine Learning and what it can do. It's becoming a really exciting product. I'm very, very excited to kind of learn about this as it grows as well.
Yeah, I think even in the DevOps world, it's still pretty exciting too. And you know, I'll put out an example once it is ready for GitHub Actions, right? It's a pretty simple, you know, setup. You take advantage of doing CI/CD with MLflow as well. All right, so for MLflow, I mean, MLflow is pretty exciting for data scientists and ML engineers, but there's also some exciting stuff you can do with it with GitHub Actions for your DevOps engineers. So basically what I've done here is created this GitHub example for automated deployment for MLflow. And so what we've basically done here is created a bunch of scripts separating out the steps that I just showed you in the first example. So all of that was in a notebook. I pretty much just turned that into a bunch of Python scripts. And what I've done here is created a GitHub action that'll go ahead and just pull in these scripts and run the training job. All right, so all the conda environment, all those dependencies are already with the model, as I showed you there earlier. So it makes it really simple to, you know, go with this workflow. All right, so basically what I'm doing here is just installing my dependencies. I have a script that'll pull in that workspace that I showed you earlier, compute that I'm using, and then just doing a quick configuration with the MLflow model. So in this step, what I'm basically doing is just setting that tracking URI with AzureML, and then going in and running the model in here. So I can show you real quick what that looks like. This is basically the training script I'm running in there. And so what I've done here is authenticated into my workspace and then submitting that project. Super simple, basically what I showed in the notebook. And you can pretty much change up the compute. In this case, I'm using a GPU cluster. And then what I'll end up doing is after the script is done in that workflow, I pretty much just register the model in AzureML. So you can see that right here. See the experiments that I just ran for these previously, and then the models that get automatically registered in that workflow. So we'll make sure these are available soon.
Yeah, that's really important. Having that whole pipeline that triggers on code changes and so on to automate that stuff, which is what we're all about in the DevOps world and MLOps these days. Yeah,
definitely.
Cool. Well, we will definitely put show notes so people can get their hands on some of that information as well. Look, thank you so much for joining me, Shivani. It's an awesome looking feature that we've got now.
Yeah, it's great. Really glad it was easily understandable.
Yeah. Awesome. And to everybody else, thanks so much for joining us, and we'll see you next time on the DevOps Lab.